The story of a football season has many faces. In 1980, old familiar faces turned up in unfamiliar places. A snake was loose in Houston. A forgotten quarterback became a savior in Oakland. And a former saint named Conrad Dobler played a vital role in a Cinderella story in Buffalo.
You know, a lot of people talk about Buffalo this year being a Cinderella team. And, you know, I'm not saying that I'm a big part of it, but I am a part of it. You know, when I went to St. Louis was termed as a Cinderella team under Don Coryell. The same way last year in New Orleans, we had the opportunity to knock the Rams out of the playoffs and go ourselves. We didn't get that accomplished. They call us a Cinderella team there. They're calling Buffalo right now a Cinderella team. I think that's all fine and dandy.
For many, like the Buffalo Bills, 1980 was indeed a fairy tale. But for others, like the Pittsburgh Steelers and their perfectionist coach, Chuck Knoll, it was a year to forget. In 1980, the City of Champions became football's Paradise Lost. The stumbling Steelers won only two games in their division and missed the playoffs for the first time in 9 years. 1980 was a season that took its shape from the losers just as much as from the winners. When the New Orleans Saints came stumbling in, defeat was sure to follow, as well as their loyal but embarrassed fans who hid their heads in shame. The Saints became the Aints and were scored on more times than any team in the NFL and lost more games in one season than any team in history. But 1980 also proved that for every sinner, there's always hope of redemption. After two straight losing seasons in Detroit, the prayers of Coach Monty Clark were finally answered. A savior named Billy Sims arrived and took the Lions and all of Motor City for an exhilarating ride. Sims' salary classified him as an extravagant gas guzzler, but he got good mileage per carry and led the NFL in touchdowns. The Lions dusted off five of their first six opponents and ended the first half of the season on a winning note.
Are you ready for this? Are you sitting on the edge of your seat? Hey, hey, come out and watch the Detroit Lions that no one can seem to beat. Hey, hey, and another one bites the dust. And another one bites the dust. All right.
This same sweet music was not heard in the second half of the season. In a crucial game on Thanksgiving Day, the Lions allowed Vince Evans of the Bears to tie the score on the last play of the game. Then, in sudden death overtime, the Lions died the suddenest of deaths.
We're underway here in overtime. Davey Williams at the 5, to the 10, to the 15, to the 20. He breaks through to the 25, to the 30. Coming to the near sideline. He's to the 40. He's to the 50. Down the sideline. He's to the 30. He may score. He's going to win it. A kickoff return by Davey Williams. 95 yards. And the Bears win it in unbelievable fashion. A 95-yard kickoff return, and the Bears are absolutely going crazy. You think they want a playoff spot today?
Think what this has to do to Detroit.
Oh, my goodness.
In the NFC Central, there was a full measure of good days and bad. But the last days and the best days belonged to the Minnesota Vikings. In the season's waning weeks, they raced past the fading Lions and won the division title on Tommy Kramer's wing and a prayer of a pass against the Cleveland Browns.
23-22 in favor of Cleveland. 5 seconds left, first down, Cleveland 46. Three wide receivers right, Kramer back to pass. He's going deep, down the right side, and it is fought for, and it's
touchdown!
Rashawn! Rashawn! I don't believe it! I don't believe it! The Vikings are in the playoffs! Absolutely one of the great dramatic finishes of any football game, anywhere. The Vikings go to the playoffs! 28-23!
For seven consecutive years, the Saints and other sinners in the NFC West watched Ray Malavasi's Los Angeles Rams win their division. Thunderous defense marked the Rams' reign. But in 1980, the usually conservative Los Angeles offense was touched by lightning. An attack once dominated by the four-yard rush exploded in the hands of quarterback Vince Ferragamo. 30 touchdown passes, plus the league's most productive running attack, had the Rams on the road to their accustomed championship. But then came a last-second collision with the Atlanta Falcons.
Here it is, 4th and 11 at the Falcon 46. Bartkowski. Back to throw. Here come the Rams.
There it is.
Bart's got time. He's going long.
There it is.
He's got Jackson. He catches it. Falcons win.
Atlanta had never won a championship. But now the Falcons, the NFL's second youngest team, realized they could unseat the Rams. Three factors spurred the overthrow, beginning with William Andrews and Lynn Cain, number 21, 1980's best backfield. The offensive line play was superb and enabled Steve Bartkowski to pass for a league-leading 31 touchdowns. There was an eager young defense built around a core of rookies who hit like all pros. Atlanta won 12 games, including 10 in a row. And when they beat the 49ers on the season's 15th Sunday, the Falcons were champions at last.
Division champs. First time ever in Atlanta. Western Division champs.
While Atlanta was bringing down the final curtain in the NFC West, the longest running mystery play continued its run in New England. Once again, the Patriots were cast in the leading role in the East, only to lose the part to an understudy that had neither their talent nor looks. Buffalo's rise and New England's fall produced a division race that showed football is still a game where character counts as much as talent. With the division's best athletes, Ron Erhardt's Patriots were puzzling.
Oh, man, all they had to do was just drop it to me. It would have been a walk-in.
Really?
Oh, cover two, I couldn't believe
it. Nobody covered Stanley on the pick.
New England was frequently victimized by their own faults.
Come on, let's tackle.
As much as by the skills of others.
So try to go to Washington.
We got Washington, Coach?
Going to Washington as much as he can.
Come on. What the hell?
Going to Washington.
What a laugh.
Patriot inconsistency was costly because there was a storm brewing in the north. A generation of kids had seen Lake Erie freeze over, but they had never seen their Buffalo Bills defeat the Miami Dolphins. On opening day, Buffalo beat Miami for the first time in a decade. suddenly, the team with the AFC's worst record in the 70s was displaying character when it counted in the 80s.
In their shotgun formation at the Jets' 31-yard line, 12 seconds to play. Ferguson looking to throw. He throws toward the end zone, and it is caught for a touchdown!
Unbelievable!
Buffalo's ability to produce wins in the clutch enabled them to challenge the Patriots for division supremacy. Their weapons included the NFL's top-ranked defense and rookie runner Joe Cribbs. Quarterback Joe Ferguson helped Buffalo defeat the NFL's top teams. And with two games to go, the Bills were only one victory away from the playoff ball. But by week 15, the Cinderella Bills were dancing towards midnight. Buffalo lost to New England 24-2. Suddenly, the Patriots would win the division if the Bills were to lose their season finale. But just before the clock struck 12, the spirit of a champion swirled out of the fog and drizzle of a San Francisco Sunday.
The Bills need to hold them to win their first division title since 66. 2 seconds to play. There's the long throw toward the end zone, and it is deflected, incomplete, and the game is over, and the Bills have won the division championship. What a dramatic finish in the fog and the rain of San Francisco.
...1980 opened with the AFC Central dressed in style and colored a distinctive hue.
Love, love your blue.
Love Your Blues patron saint was Bum Phillips, a country gentleman who had twice led Houston into the AFC Championship game, only to lose it to the Pittsburgh Steelers. Bum bet his job that 1980 would be different.
Last year, we knocked on the door. This year, we beat on the door. Next year, we're going to kick it in.
Kick it in was the battle cry as Houston tore into Pittsburgh with its vaunted Earl Campbell up-the-gut offense. All season long, the world champion and number one contender stood at center ring and slugged it out. While attention focused on the favorites and their slogans, a sleeper was stirring on the shores of Lake Erie. The Cleveland Browns play in ancient municipal stadium, a dreary place known as the Mistake by the Lake. The Browns' biggest mistake was landing in the same division as the team of the decade. During the 70s, Pittsburgh won four Super Bowls while Cleveland's lot was so humble that a 9-7 record in 1979 was enough to make Sam Ratigliano AFC Coach of the Year. Ratigliano's formula for success was simple.
What we do best, and it begins and ends with pass protection, is throwing a football. And beside anything else that you would do would be increasingly boring.
Boring, the Brown offense was not. Stimulating, scintillating, and hair-raising it was. Cleveland's cutting edge was quarterback Brian Sipe. Since 1973, Sipe had risen from the obscurity of Cleveland's taxi squad to NFL Player of the Year with the help of a former college basketball player named Dave Logan. A prototype tight end, Ozzie Newsome, and a crafty old pro, Reggie Rucker. These three musketeers and D'Artagnan had a flair for the dramatic. 14 times in two seasons, they had come from behind to win with less than 2 minutes to play.
Down to 34 seconds, and the Cardiac Kids are at work today.
Oh, it's time to get nervous. Sipe, third and 20, throwing to Logan.
He got it on the 20, and 5, touchdown, Dave Logan! Touchdown by Dave Logan, 46 yards, I don't believe it!
Touchdown, Brown, 16 seconds remaining, what a play!
While Pittsburgh and Houston battled at the front door, Cleveland flew through the attic window and into first place. On the final Sunday of the regular season, Cleveland needed a win in frigid Cincinnati to clinch the Central Division title. Rettigliano had set the tone the night before.
Our goal tomorrow is to win a division. Tomorrow, we have to protect number 17. And that's it offensively. No do's and don'ts. If they do this, we do that. And how about this and how about that? Hey, we've done all that. We have thrown the football and won. And it'll hold up. And you will be able to play with that kind of an intellectual initiative.
But the Bengals refused to follow Rutigliano's script. They sacked number 17, then matched Cleveland score for score and blow for blow. In one of the season's most spectacular games, the lead changed hands 6 times. But true to their thoroughbred form, Cleveland had what it took at the wire.
2 seconds, 1 second is over! The Browns have won the championship!
Just a second! I got my best line of the year, man. Got my best line of the year. Bum Phillips knocked on the wrong door.
Sam Rettigliano, coach of the year for the second season in a row, this time as a champion. To look at the San Diego Chargers was to gaze at pro football's future. Their sophisticated passing offense was the equivalent of space age technology, manned by graceful sky pilots who set their sights on a Super Bowl dream. To attain it, all they had to do was blast off. San Diego rode the crest of this new wave to its second straight AFC West title. The San Diego Chargers gained more yards in one season than any other team in NFL history. The Chargers not only soared past opponents, they soared above them. The San Diego Chargers ascended the heights of excellence. Their trademarks were daring and dazzling. But a battered collection of world-weary veterans from Oakland would meet the Chargers at the end of the line. The Raiders gained new life from an unexpected source, Jim Plunkett. After a decade of obscurity, Plunkett enjoyed the best season of his career. Number 85, Bob Chandler, was another veteran cast off who was rejuvenated in Oakland. Chandler and Plunkett revived a Raider tradition built on the big play. Another reason why this once mighty empire was able to strike back in 1980 was defense. Cornerback Lester Hayes constituted a force that generated big defensive plays. His 13 interceptions paced the Raiders to the NFL lead in that department. All phases of Oakland's defense were programmed to deliver the killing blow. Only one AFC team registered more quarterback sacks than Oakland. The San Diego Chargers. While their offense flew on the wings of Mercury, their defensive line struck with a hammer of Thor. Those entrusted with the job of protecting quarterbacks from the Chargers knew only frustration. Protectors like Kansas City center Jack Rudney, number 58.
Hold him up! It's the last sack of the day. Business, guts, character. Let's go! My fault, Bull. Damn it, my fault.
I lean to Louie and Johnson comes inside and I can't get back on him. He splits our seam.
Tight in here. Watch your knees, Wilbur.
I've never had that kind of trouble covering inside in my life. I don't understand it.
Rudney's bewilderment was echoed by others throughout the season, and especially by the Buffalo Bills, who fell victim to the Chargers' perfect blend of strength and speed during the playoffs. Meanwhile, in wind-chilled Cleveland, the Raiders very nearly breathed their last breath of playoff life.
The ball on the 13-yard line of the Raiders, who lead 14-12. But with Cleveland needing only a field goal, the Browns appear to be in the driver's seat. Raiders on the thin edge now. Sipe looks. He throws! And it's intercepted! Holy
These old warriors were survivors. They next ventured to a contemporary Camelot, intent on restoring their empire once and for all. They faced young knights who desired to become the once and future kings of pro football.
From San Diego's Jack Murphy Stadium, it's the American Football Conference championship game between the Oakland Raiders and the San Diego Chargers, the winner to advance to New Orleans in Super Bowl 15 in 2 weeks.
The young knights and the old warriors carved a battlefield in the sky. The Chargers showed why they had reigned as the NFL's masters of the air. But the Raiders' defensive mastery ended that reign. A savior named Plunkett regained control of the airways, just as he had taken control of a career that was presumed dead. He and the Oakland Raiders were very much alive. Finally, the San Diego Chargers' vision of a Super Bowl came plummeting to earth. Their future was all used up.
Watch those glowing hopes dwindle away as now the darkness closes over San Diego Jack Murphy Stadium. Darkness that symbolizes the end of the Charger dream.
For the Oakland Raiders, the dream goes on.
The jubilation begins. The Raiders are bound for the Super Bowl for the third time. Climaxing one of the great stories in football in recent years, the resurgence, the total resurgence of the silver and black. New Orleans, here come the Raiders.
On September 11, 1980, the Philadelphia Eagles under Dick Vermeil paved a road to their first championship in 20 years. Blocking their path were the Dallas Cowboys, champions of the NFC East 10 out of the past 14 seasons. The Eagles were stoked by the fires that burned in Dick Vermeil.
Give him what you got, you're all stirred on the right side.
The Cowboys reflected cool, calm, and collected Tom Landry. Dallas fans were smug, bred to a winning tradition, more in tune to fashion shows than football games. Style was alien to Philadelphia's fanatic fans. They sported the look of bowling alleys and the scent of mustard and soft pretzels. Sensing the collapse of the Cowboy Empire, they stood like barbarians at the gates of Rome. The battering ram of the Eagles was its defense, a unit that consisted of more spit than polish, more grit than glitter. Philadelphia played the least complicated defense in pro football, but in this simplicity was beauty. They allowed the fewest yards in the NFC and gave up the fewest points in the NFL. When the Eagle defense sang their siren song, opponents washed up on the rocks of defeat. Prior to the season, the conservative Eagle offense was considered a sharp right turn from Ronald Reagan. In 1980, they liberalized an attack which featured the running of Wilbert Montgomery and the passes of quarterback Ron Jaworski to Harold Carmichael. The Eagles were talented, but they won as often from determination and a capacity for hard work.
Right left slot, run pass, 49 toss, halfback option, pass and a go down. Charlie heads up, but go down. Set, go!
Practice made perfect. Plays formulated on the training field, translated into touchdowns on Sunday. This dream of a team raced to an 11-1 record, and a championship appeared inevitable until injuries and fatigue brought on a late season slump. Suddenly, the Dallas Cowboys appeared over their shoulders. Quarterback Danny White was thought to need a year to settle into Roger Staubach's shoes, but in his own shoes, he threw the most touchdown passes in Cowboy history. While Danny White led Dallas to the most points in the NFL, a raging bull named Randy White was the explosive core of its defense. The Cowboys scrambled after the Eagles for 15 weeks. Until the hustle of White number 54 chased them down in the season's final game. Cowboy victory gave both teams identical records, but because Dallas won the game by less than 25 points, the championship of the NFC East belonged to the Eagles.
Those guys that have been here for 5 years, and I'm not slighting the people that have been here for 4 and 3 and 2 and 1, but those guys that have been here for 5 years and have been booed, have been told that they've been treated brutal, have been worked too hard. Looking at Harold Carmichael and Bergie and Bunning and Carl over here and guys that have been here, Stanley Walters, Guy Morris, Charlie Smith, who couldn't play today. I don't want to forget any of you guys because I never will. Hey, thank you for what you've done for me.
All right.
In Atlanta, it was the Cowboys who were close to tears as they faced playoff extinction with 49 seconds left in the game.
Here come the Cowboys, still with 49 seconds to go. Ball at the 23, 27, 24. Danny White with one running back. Here comes the blitz again. Danny back to throw into the end zone. Caught! Touchdown!
It was deja vu. A flashback to the Hail Mary pass in the 1975 playoffs. Then and now, the savior of a season was Drew Pearson. One step away from the Super Bowl, the Cowboys issued a challenge.
We're on our way, baby. Can you hear that? We're on our way.
Which the Eagles naturally accepted.
We want Dallas. Dallas. We hate you. Dallas.
Right here.
At the fence. At the fence.
The story of the National Conference ended the way it had started. The Eagles and the Cowboys on a collision course for the championship. For the third time in 1980, the Cowboys met the Eagles. But this time, the championship of the National Conference was at stake. The favored Cowboys presented the kind of challenge Dick Vermeil knew his Eagles could meet.
Years back, when we were struggling to win 5 and 6 and 7 games, a lot of people used to take the Eagles for granted. A lot of guys have heard me say, never allow anybody to take you for granted. I have a feeling that the Cowboys are sort of taking us for granted right now. We're here because we've earned the right to be here, and we've played well enough to be here. And we can beat this football team. If the Dallas Cowboys are going to take us for granted, we'll whip their ass.
Sack him, Kurt!
Dick, stop!
Well, that eye slant wasn't bad the first time we ran it, huh? The eye slant's been good, Dick.
High formation. High formation.
Quick, 141.
High formation, quick, 141.
Should be there, Dick. Should be there.
Second down and 10, the Cowboys with 6 defensive backs. Jaworski gives off inside, running with Montgomery up the right side. Left 30, 45, 40, 50, 10, touchdown! How about Montgomery? Montgomery exposed on the right side, and the Eagles have scored first. Jaworski went for Montgomery and Robert Gamble 42 yards for a touchdown.
Dick,
yeah.
Alert dog. Now, they haven't dogged us yet.
Hey, wait a minute! Hey, they can't stop the two guys in and
they
back
can't
out.
Do that. Get the
they
referee, Dick.
That.
Dick, that's a penalty, tell him. Dick, what that's a penalty.
Hey, if they substitute people in, they've got to stay in. They cannot go back out. They've got to be in for one play. Even I know that. Yeah, now they did it!
They did it.
Damn it, they did it! Yeah, well, it should be a penalty!
Yeah. Hey, Dick, just settle down. You're going to have to call some good plays here. I got to stay calm now. Run behind Woody, Jerry says, because he's really taking care of Cole.
All right, I want slot split, 18 flip.
18 flip.
I said 18 flip!
Yeah, should be good. Now he called the wrong one. It's all right. Yeah. He called the other one. He wanted the other one. It's all right.
I called 18 flip, not 48 flip. All right?
All right, but it worked good.
Good call. All
right. A long yard, Dick. Dick?
Huh?
About 1 yard.
All right, deuce wing, 15 base. Leave Wilbert in there.
Dick,
yeah.
Got two downs here probably to make it.
Yeah.
Carmichael split wide to the near side. It's a pitch to Montgomery. Off right tackle. 25-30. 35-40. 45 midfield. Montgomery to the 45, to the 40, to the 35, and drives out of the Cowboys 25-yard line. Robert Montgomery having his day of days.
Dick, yeah, great call. Thank you. Beautiful. I tell you, I think I do a better job without too many suggestions.
I know. I think so, too.
All right, slot split. I want 47 slant.
This should be a touchdown right here, Dick.
Yeah.
Should be a score.
Jaworski on the delay to Leroy Harris up the middle across the line. Touchdown, Eagles!
Going to New Orleans!
I tell you where you're going. We're going to the Super Bowl. You know, he's going to the Super Bowl, right?
There's gonna be a celebration. We can see our ships coming. Though we met some competition on the way, it was tiring, it was testing, it was almost never ending. But we all pulled through and won the accolade. Now look, we've made it. We've made it to the top. Now that we've made it, we ain't never gonna stop.